Body has various mechanisms to provide defense against foreign agent, and this foreign agent can be bacterial infection, fungus, viral infection. So there are two basic types of mechanism. One is the innate immunity and the other is the acquired immunity. And this innate immunity is present since birth. However, this acquired immunity starts after exposure of the antigen, that is the foreign agent. Okay, so it is not like that indiscriminately it will attack any foreign agent, but there should be a specific foreign agent which kind of acts on certain cells on the body, and then only there is activation of this acquired immunity. And this acquired immunity is again of two types, cell mediated immunity and humoral immunity. And in cell mediated immunity, basically, it is the T cells which are the hero of the cell mediated immunity, while humoral immunity, that means there are certain soluble mediators. It is not carried out by cells. When we say it is not carried out by cells, basically we have B cells, okay? But they sit in their places in lymphoid organs and they do not go and travel in the entire blood searching for the foreign agent. Instead, they release antibodies which are circulating. So that is why they are known as humoral immunity. In this video, we will focus on details of cell-mediated immunity. So first let us see how these cells are formed and how they are going to the various places in the body so as to look for the antigen. So here we have hematopoietic stem cells. Okay, this is hematopoietic stem cells and this is a bone. Okay, so these hematopoietic stem cells are present in the bone marrow. And these hematopoietic stem cells can give rise to many cells, the red blood cells, platelets, WBCs, all type of WBCs. But here we are focusing on the development of the T cells, right? So you see that there is common lymphoid progenitor cell, and lymphoid progenitor means it is going to give rise to lymphocytes, okay? So in this lymphoid progenitor cell, again, we have two types. That is lymphoid progenitor cell, which can give rise to B cells. So that is known as B cell precursors. Okay, B cell precursors. And the other we have is T cell precursors. So you see here it is going as two different cells. Okay, so these T cell precursors are the ones which are going to form the T cells, which is important for the cell mediated immunity. Now these B cell precursors remain in the bone marrow during development. For the development of these B cells, they remain in the bone marrow. And development here, we are using a specific term, that is pre-processing. Pre-processing. We'll see in the context of T cells what is pre-processing. So B cells remain in bone marrow for pre-processing, while T cells move to the thymus for pre-processing. And what is happening in this pre-processing, that these T cells, first of all, they are T cell precursors. They are going to form, differentiate into particular T cells, which are going to divide rapidly. So that is known as proliferation. They are going to divide rapidly. So large pool of cells they are going to form, and they are going to attain diversity. So two things are happening. Okay. Large pool of cells and attainment of diversity. Now, in this pool of cells which are formed, what we get is different types of T cells. That means T cells, they have certain specific proteins on their membrane, and these proteins, they are known as CD4, where CD stands for cluster of differentiation. And there is another set of T cells which have another protein known as CD8, cluster of differentiation 8. So these cells are known as CD4 positive T cells, and these cells are known as, with the CD8, they are known as CD8 positive T cells. So this CD4 positive T cells, another name is helper T cells. Okay, and CD8 positive T cells, they are known as cytotoxic T cells. Okay, so first thing that is happening there. Now these helper T cells and cytotoxic T cells, a lot of pools will be there. And as I said, that there will be attainment of diversity. And diversity means what? That these cells have on their surface a T cell receptor. Okay, T cell receptor will be there. So, each cell is having multiple T cells of receptors. So, this cell probably there are thousands of T cell receptor on the surface. But for a cell, the T cell receptor is specific for one antigen. So, one type of cell with one type of T cell can bind to only one type of antigen. Okay. And similarly, we have thousands and thousands of T cells. So, this concept where we have, say, suppose 10, 20 T cells with only one type of receptor, that is known as a clone of T cell. Clone of T cell. Then the other will be another clone of T cell because that is binding to another antigen, right? So this is like clone A, we can say, which is binding to one antigen. Clone B can bind to another antigen. So such kind of diversity is attained in the thymus. So that is very much fundamental for the function of the T cells. So apart from these two things, proliferation and attainment of diversity, one more very important thing happens that is known as negative clonal selection. Negative clonal selection. Okay, what is this negative clonal selection? See, body has its own antigens as well, and we don't want these T cells to go and react with the body antigens. When the diversity is happening, it is like random diversity. It doesn't just selects the antigen. It's not like, okay, this particular bacterial antigen, this particular T cell is going to react. It's not like that. It's random. So much randomness is there that just by the matter of chance, it is able to react to so many antigens which are present in the environment and which happen to enter into the body. But this negative clonal selection is important because suppose in this randomness, there are certain T cells with the T cell receptor which have the ability to react with our body antigen. So that we don't want. We want that these T cells should be removed. So what happens in thymus that body antigen is brought to the T cell with its receptor, okay? And if this body antigen is able to combine with this receptor, then this T cell undergoes apoptosis. So this is known as negative clonal selection. We want the apoptosis of the cells which react with our body antigen. So all the body antigens reach to the thymus via circulation, okay, and they come in contact with these T cells so that these T cells are destroyed. When is all this process happening? All this is happening during fetal life and mostly just before birth. Just before birth and few months even after birth. Okay, few months after birth. So that is why we say that T cell development mostly takes place in thymus in few months after birth. And if thymus is removed during that time, then we will have deficient lymphocytes. So thymus is very important for the development of cell-mediated immunity. So this is what we discussed. We discussed pre-processing, that is proliferation of the cells, formation of CD4 and CD8 cells, attainment of the diversity, and also negative clonal selection. So these four processes form the pre-processing which happens in the thymus. Now, once the T cells of various clones form in the thymus, they just don't sit in the thymus. They move into the circulation and they go to the various sites in the body, right? Now, this pre-processing and the initial development which has happened in the bone marrow, so this bone marrow and thymus, there is a particular name for these organs. This is known as primary lymphoid organs, okay? Primary lymphoid organs. Also, you will see in certain books another name, that is the central lymphoid organs. Okay, and in some good books, it is written another name as well, that is generative lymphoid organs. Okay, so it has three names where the initial development takes place. After the development, as I said, they move into the circulation. So once they move, they enter into the blood. Okay, then via the capillaries, in between the capillaries, there are certain spaces. Okay, they move out of those spaces into the interstitial tissue and then via the lymph, okay, they are carried to various lymph nodes of the body. So they reach to the lymph nodes, and from the blood, as it is passing through the spleen also, they reside in the spleen as well. So to the lymph nodes, spleen, Plus, there is mucosal linings, cutaneous mucosal linings also. There also they reside. It means sub-epithelial layer of skin, GIT. Wherever there is probability of the organism entering into the body, right? Respiratory tract. They sit there and wait for the antigen. And mucosal lining, very important mucosal linings where these T cells are present, or we say mucosal lymphoid organs or mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. MALT, mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. These are Peyer's patches in GIT, right? Then we have tonsils, very important, right? Mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. So these T cells go and reside in these various regions, and this is known as secondary lymphoid organs. Secondary lymphoid organs. Understanding primary lymphoid organs and secondary lymphoid organs. Now in the secondary lymphoid organs, we have these T cells. We also have B cells there, which have developed in the bone marrow, and they have also gone there and sitting there and waiting for any attack on the body. Plus, there are other cells also, that is the antigen presenting cells, which we'll see what is happening. So let us see what is the structure of this lymphoid tissue. So here you see there is a lymph node shown, and you see there are particular areas where these B cells and T cells are sitting. In lymph node, we have B lymphocytes, okay? B lymphocytes. This we'll deal in another video on humoral immunity. And this paracortical area, we have T cell area. So here B lymphocytes is in cortical area, it forms the follicles, and paracortical we have T cell area. So particular areas are there. Plus along with these T cells and B cells, we have antigen presenting cells also. And remember one term here, that these T cells, which have not yet been exposed to the antigen, they have just formed and moved to the particular lymph node. These T cells are known as naive T cells. Naive. They are new, they are inexperienced, they don't know the antigen. They just go and sit there, naive T cells. Now, for proper immune mechanism, four important things are required. One, antigen recognition. T cells should be able to recognize a particular antigen. There should be T cell activation. They are still naive cells, they should activate. Then elimination of the antigen, and then suppression of the response. We don't want too much hyperactivity of the immune system as well. So let us see each of these steps one by one. So first, coming to antigen recognition, and this happens by means of antigen presenting cells. And this concept of antigen recognition, I have already dealt in detail in another video. I have given the link in the description section. You can check on that. So here we will talk in brief only. So what we are seeing, that how antigen presenting cells present the antigen to the T cells. So why this antigen presentation first of all is required? Antigen has entered into the body, right? Say suppose this is GI tract, okay? This is the lumen, and here some foreign antigen is there, and this is the lining, okay? So there are various levels of defense. There is mucosal lining is also a defense that is part of innate immunity. But suppose it breaches this and reaches inside into the interstitial tissue where lymphatics are there. And there is subepithelial lining where I am telling that these T cells, B cells are sitting also, right? So once it breaches, what will happen, that below this lining, there are huge number of antigen presenting cells. And very important of these antigen presenting cells are dendritic cells, macrophages. And B cells also carry out this function. Now these dendritic cells, for the first presentation, they are very, very important, right? Now what happens, that these antigen presenting cells, they present the antigen to the T cells, because these T cells cannot identify an intact floating antigen. So these antigen presenting cells will phagocytose the antigen, okay? And you see, they will break it down into small particles, and this particle, in association with the MHC protein, major histocompatibility complex protein, it is being presented to the T cell receptor present on the T cells. So please remember that T cell identifies only a cell associated protein. It doesn't identify a soluble intact protein. For that, we have antibodies which go and react with these free floating antigen. T cells for cell attached antigen or cell associated antigen. So this MHC is going to present it to the T cell receptor. But two, three things you should remember here. First, that as I told you before, there are different types of T cells. There's CD4 helper T cells and CD8 positive cytotoxic T cells. So they have these different proteins, CD4 and CD8 also. Now, this presentation is MHC restricted. That is, these antigen presenting cells have MHC2 protein. And with MHC2 protein, they present to the CD4 positive T cells or helper T cells. Now, how they present that this MHC2 has a receptor for CD4 as well. And this CD4 protein comes and binds to this particular space on MHC2. So this is known as co-receptor. Okay, co-receptor. Only then there will be appropriate presentation. Otherwise, how will macrophage know or how will any APC know that it is presenting the cell to helper T cell? It might be cytotoxic T cell also, right? So there is association with CD4 also, and that is known as co-receptor. Plus, there is association of other cell adhesion molecules as well. And this association is important for co-stimulation. Co-stimulation. So there are two stimulation. One is binding with the T cell receptor and another is further binding with other proteins. So here what we have is these proteins on the APCs are known as B7 proteins. Basically, these are cell adhesion molecules, and like CD4 and CD8, they also have certain proteins named with CD, say suppose CD80 on the antigen presenting cell and CD28 on the CD4 positive or helper T cell. So this association is also important, and what we get is two signals from this, right? Signal one from this, right? And signal two from the association of the cell adhesion molecules. And both the signals are important for T cell activation. Suppose there is only one signal, then the T cell will not activate. Instead, the T cell will become useless. That is known as energy. Okay, energy. So both the signals are important for T cell activation. That is very important to remember, because certain drugs have been made which block the co-stimulation and make the cell T cell inactive. So that can be used as an immunosuppression strategy. So that was for CD4 cell. Coming to CD8 cell. CD8 cell, here the presentation is by MHC1. MHC1, by the way, is present in all the cells. So these antigen presenting cells will have MHC2 as well as MHC1. However, there are other cells, all the nucleated cells of the body, they have MHC1 and not MHC2, and they can present only to the CD8 cells or cytotoxic lymphocytes. So this MHC1, there is antigen presentation to the T cell receptor of the cytotoxic lymphocyte. So again, there should be another association with the CD8, right? So that is the co-receptor. And again, there are adhesion proteins, that is for the co-stimulation. And then only there will be signal 1 and signal 2 in the T cells. So two signals are required for activation. Now, once the signal comes, what happens once there is binding of the antigen with the T cell receptor? What is going to happen? So here is this diagram of T cell receptor. You see what is happening. These are the alpha beta subunits of the T cell receptor. Okay, so these alpha beta subunits are important for the variedness or heterogeneity of the T cell receptor, right? So this is T cell heterodimer. This is the antigen presenting cell and this is the T cell. Now you see that this alpha beta heterodimer, that is a T cell receptor, is associated with some other subunits, and what this forms is CD3 complex. We'll not go into the detail, but just remember this CD3 complex is important for signal transduction. Signal transduction means what? That what is happening inside the cell once this T cell receptor binds to the antigen. So as you might be knowing, you might have read in endocrinology the mechanism of hormone action, that when the hormone binds to its ligands, there is some phosphorylation, dephosphorylation inside the cell. Similar thing happens here when both the signal comes, ultimately leading to increase in the calcium levels in the cell. And this, along with calmodulin, so calcium binds with calmodulin and causes rise in another protein, that is calcineurin. Basically, activation of the calcineurin occurs, right? And this in turn leads to activation of a transcription factor which goes and binds to the genes, leading to increase in the production of interleukin 2. So here we are talking about the CD4 plus T cells, right? So this interleukin 2 production is very important for the function of this helper T cells, right? And why I talked about this, because there are drugs which act here, right? They block the production of the calcineurin. Your drug cyclosporin, tacrolimus, the immunosuppressive drugs which you know, they block the production of this calcineurin, and hence they block the production of interleukin 2. So that's why you should know a little bit about the mechanism of T cell activation. Fine. Now, once all this happens, there are certain changes within the cell. We'll go again to the macro level. What is happening to these T cells? So once these T cells get activated, there is another term which is used for them, that is effector T cells. So before we use the term of naive T cells, now after activation, they have become effector T cells. And these effector T cells, what will happen, that they have the capacity to further become a particular type of helper T cells. So further helper T cells has certain subsets, and these are Th1, Th2, Th17 and T regulatory cells. Okay, why is this important? This is important. Simple word, you remember, helper T cells help all other immune cells. But depending on which helper T subset is forming, particular type of immune cells will be helped. Okay, so it's not that once activated, all T helper subsets will be formed. No, it depends on that which antigen is interacting with the T cell, helper T cells. And further, because of this, the dendritic cell or the antigen presenting cell which is there, it is going to release certain interleukins. It is going to release certain chemicals which are going to act on T cells. These chemicals ultimately change something within the cells which act on genes, and this will change the proteins which are being secreted from the T cells, right? So depending on what antigen presenting cells are secreting which is acting on the T cells, T cells will further differentiate into subsets, Th1 or Th2 or Th17 and T regulatory cells. T regulatory cells generally are formed. Okay, so what is this Th1 cells? See, whenever the antigen presenting cell takes up a intracellular antigen, intracellular bacteria or viruses or cancer cells, right? Because these cells also will be there, right? They will be taken up by the antigen presenting cells. They are going to affect other cells of the body as well, right? So virus is there. Virus is going to infect the cells, but it is going to infect the dendritic cells also. It is going to infect the macrophages also, which are going to break it down and present the antigen. So intracellular antigens, intracellular bacteria, intracellular viruses and cancer cells, when they are presented to the T helper cells, then they differentiate into Th1 cells. Very important. So you will remember that these cells are presented only to cytotoxic T cells. If anybody knows about it, yes, these antigens are presented to cytotoxic T cells, but the antigen presenting cells, as I told you, they have both types of MHC, MHC1 also, MHC2 also. So at one hand, they are going to present the antigen with MHC2 to T helper cells, and on the other hand, with MHC1, they are going to present it to cytotoxic T cells also. So to both the cells it is presenting. Understanding, antigen presenting cells can present to both the cells. So this was a little divergence. because some people may get confused if they already know that what is happening to the cytotoxic T cells. So just a little concept clearance here. So anyways, back to our concept that if antigen presenting cell presents intracellular surviving bacteria, viruses and cancer cells to the helper T cells, then they differentiate into Th1 type subset, and this Th1 type subset secretes interleukin-2 and interferon gamma. Okay, very important. This interleukin-2 acts and activates the cytotoxic T cells, right? And this interferon gamma goes and acts on the macrophages itself so as to increase the ability of the macrophage to kill the cells, okay? So the killing mechanisms of the macrophages are upgraded. They become more intensive. So this Th1 subset acts on cytotoxic cells again to kill the cells which are infected, and interferon gamma acts on the macrophages itself, causes its further activation. Second thing what happens, that these IL-2, it also acts again on this T helper cells, again acts on this T helper cells, and it causes proliferation of this T helper cells. So the clone is expanding here. Right, and what will happen that after expansion it will go and sit in the various places again in the body. So you see, suppose from GIT the antigen has entered, there it encounters this APCs which present the antigen to the helper T cell. So these helper T cells proliferate. Now we don't know that maybe this antigen has already crossed the barrier and it has entered into the circulation, or maybe sitting in some other lymph node. So that's why these T helper cells proliferate and go to various places again. So activated T cell from one site again goes and recirculates in the body, sit at various places, and also to find the antigen where it is. Okay. So that is another thing. Second thing is, suppose the antigen which is presented by the antigen presenting cell, it is parasites or it is an allergen. Then there is formation of Th2 cells, okay, and these Th2 cells secrete interleukin-4, interleukin-5 and interleukin-13. Interleukin-4 and 5 are responsible for the B cell proliferation and maturation, and these are important for the secretion of antibody E from the B cell, and interleukin-13 is important for the recruitment of the eosinophils. Okay, so this Th2 subset is going to respond in presence of parasites or allergen in the body. Then Th17 cells, as the name suggests, 17, they secrete interleukin-17, and that is important for the recruitment of the neutrophils. And when this Th17 subset forms, that forms in presence of bacterial and fungal infections. Okay, fine. So you see, different T subsets are fighting different kinds of infection. And finally, we have T regulatory cells. These are also known as suppressor T cells. So we saw two subtypes of T cells, helper T cells and cytotoxic T cells. Now we are coming to suppressor T cells. So that is a subtype of helper T cells only. Plus, apart from this effector T cells which are formed, there is formation of some memory T cells also. Memory T cells, okay? And these are the ones, they just go and sit in the various lymph nodes for any antigen which is going to attack in the future. So they are like ready cells. If anything attacks, I am there to increase the response immediately. So this is memory T cells. So quick summary, what has happened? Antigen presenting cell presented the antigen to the naive helper T cells. With the presentation, it starts secreting interleukin-2. Interleukin-2 acts on the T cells itself, causes its proliferation with the formation of effector T cells and the memory T cells. Then, depending on the interleukins which are secreted by the antigen presenting cells, this T helper cells divides into separate subtypes, that is either Th1 cells, Th2 cells, T helper 17 cells and T regulatory cells, and they are able to excite particular immune cells which will fight particular antigens. So Th1 cells for intracellular bacteria, viruses and cancer cells, Th2 for parasite and allergen, Th17 for bacterial and fungal infections, and T regulatory which are the suppressor cells. Plus with interferon gamma, there is activation of macrophages itself, which increases its activity, its microbicidal action. So that was all about the helper T cells, which are going to help the other cells for fighting the infection. Coming to the cytotoxic T cell. Cytotoxic T cell, as I told you, that they are presented the antigen in association with MHC1. Okay. And here, this is the CD8 plus cytotoxic T cell, CD4 positive helper T cell. And you see that dendritic cell has both MHC2 and MHC1. And when it presents the antigen to the helper T cells releases interleukin-2, which activates this cytotoxic T cell, which also is being presented the antigen. Okay. And ultimately, there will be activation of this cytotoxic T cell also. Now, this cytotoxic T cell, what happens that it is being presented by the antigens by other infected cells of the body as well. So, suppose there are other cells, say suppose the alveolar cells, okay, alveolar cells get infected by any antigen, and these cells will have what? The MHC1. So they are also able to present the antigen to these cytotoxic T cells. Now, once these cytotoxic T cells are activated by this mechanism of helper T cell, they can actually kill these infected cells, right? So any infected cell or cancerous cell also, which has become abnormal, so it will have certain proteins. These proteins are presented on the surface by MHC1, and these cytotoxic T cells are going to kill those cells. And you might think that, oh my god, these are body cells, why they are being killed? But these cells are not good. A virus infected cell, what happens? Virus is replicating inside and it is using the cell's machinery to replicate. And once the cell is full of viruses, it breaks down and the virus becomes free and goes and infects other cells of the body. So it is better that this cell is killed, but the virus particles which are inside, they should not be released freely, isn't it? So there is a particular mechanism by which that is happening. You see that here this is CD8 plus T cell. So this CD8 plus T cell has certain lysosomes, modified lysosomes inside the cell, which have certain proteins. Okay. And these proteins are known as perforins and granzymes. So upon activation and binding to the antigen with MHC1, you see these enzymes are being released, perforins and granzymes. Perforin, what it does is it perforates. It creates a pore on the surface of the cell when it binds to them. And then because the pore is created, the another enzyme, granzyme, enters into the cell. And this granzyme in turn activates certain other proteins in the cell, that is the proteases. You know about caspases, in apoptosis we see caspases. So that is activated, and nucleases. What do these do? Nucleases will break down the DNA, proteases will break down all the proteins of the cell, and ultimately this cell is going to undergo apoptosis. So that is not necrosis which is happening, apoptosis is happening. Why it is important? As I told you that these abnormal proteins or the infected cell should not release the virus all over. So apoptosis means small part of the cell will disintegrate, and then macrophages will come and phagocytose these small particles. So the abnormal proteins are not being released outside, right? So this is the perforin granzyme mechanism of CD8 plus T cell killing the affected cell. So what we are seeing here? Elimination of the antigen. We saw about presentation of the antigen. We saw about activation of the T cells. We saw about the elimination of the antigen. How cytotoxic T cell is eliminating the antigen, and how helper T cell by activating the B cells and activating the neutrophils and by activating the macrophages, again it is helping in elimination of the various antigens. Just one small trivia here, that this cytotoxic T cells, we said that they are CD8 plus positive, correct? But here also we have certain subtypes of cytotoxic T cells. There is alpha beta cytotoxic T cell, there is gamma delta cytotoxic T cells, then there is NK cells, and then there are NK T cells, natural killer T cells. So this alpha beta is basically the receptor. We saw the alpha beta subunits of the T cell receptor, right? So that is the alpha beta cytotoxic T cell. If these subunits are gamma and delta, that is known as gamma delta cytotoxic T cells. And NK cells and NK T cells are other subtypes of the cytotoxic T cells. So killing mechanism is little different. That is by fast ligand interaction. And again, it is activation of the apoptosis. Fine. Moving on to the last step of immune mechanism, we saw all the three: antigen presentation, activation, elimination of antigen. Now, how this suppression of immune response is going to occur, and why this suppression is important, that we are seeing there is huge proliferation of the cells when they get activated. Plus, you see what we saw is that T cells, they release interleukin 2, which acts on itself. So more and more interleukin 2 will be released. So it is like a positive feedback. Then they release interferon gamma also. And this interferon gamma, what it is doing, it is acting on the antigen presenting cell, especially the macrophage. And macrophage, upon activation, what it will do? It will present more and more antigen to the T cells. So as T cells are proliferating and they are going to the sites of infection, whatever macrophages are there, they are getting activated and they are presenting the antigen to the T cells. More release of interleukin 2, more release of interferon gamma. So there is kind of positive feedback operating here. So that we don't want. Why? Because too much proliferation of T cells means whole lot everywhere in the body, the T cells which are responding to a particular antigen only, their number is going to become huge. And the other T cells which are for other antigens, they will become very less in number. So it will be like they will lie hidden somewhere, and if their antigen comes, that antigen presenting cells will search for these small number of T cells. Very difficult. Okay. So the number of these T cells should be kept in check. And obviously the responses should not become too much, because it is ultimately leading to inflammation and damage to the body tissues as well. We saw how cytotoxic T cells are damaging the cells. So that also has to be controlled. So how that is happening is suppression of the immune response. Now, we said about T cell activation by the antigen recognition. So we talked about MHC. So suppose this is antigen presenting cell. We talked about MHC, and here it was T cell receptor, right? Plus there is co-stimulation by the cell adhesion molecules. We said there is CD28 and CD80 proteins. Now, these T cells have another protein, that is CTLA-4. Now, what happens that once these T cells recognize the antigen, yes, there is co-stimulation, but along with that, in some time, there is this protein getting activated. Activated means more upregulation, more synthesis of this CTLA protein occurs, which goes and attaches itself to the membrane. Now, this CTLA-4 protein binds to the CD80 protein on the MHC, and it has a very high affinity for this protein. This is kind of making the co-stimulation ineffective. So, if there is a competition between CD28 and CTLA-4 to bind to this CD80 protein on the macrophage. So, CD80, 28, and this is CTLA. Okay. So within 3 to 4 hours of activation of the T cell, the CTLA goes and binds with CD80 on the antigen presenting cells, preventing the co-stimulation. So that is one mechanism of suppression of immune response. Second is that there is apoptosis of the T cells. T cells start dying after a given number of activation, and we'll not go into the details and molecular mechanism of that, but just remember that these helper T cells start dying. Then we have T regulatory cells, which we saw that it is a subset of the helper T cells, or we also call them as suppressor T cells. These T regulatory cells secrete two main interleukins, that is interleukin 10, okay, and it also releases TGF beta, transforming growth factor beta, and these interleukins go and act on the antigen presenting cells and inhibit the synthesis of MHC2 proteins and co-stimulatory proteins of the antigen presenting cells. So once that happens, the antigen presenting cells will not be able to present the antigen to the T cells anymore. So that is also going to inhibit the immune response. So that was all about the cell mediated immunity. We dealt with each of the steps in detail. Hope you liked the video. If you liked it, do press the like button, do share the video with others, and don't forget to subscribe to the channel Physiology Open. Thank you.